From making and causing some of the best games to ever come, to creating the best hub for all of our games on our PC, and to putting out some of the best discounts that you really can't ignore, Valve has become a big part of many people's lives, bringing communities together and giving us some of the best experiences we'll ever have. But how did it all start? Well, here's how Valve rose to power. Before creating Valve, Gabe Newell worked for Microsoft. He was actually very well off, having millions of dollars coding the first three versions of Windows. But after hearing about a Microsoft employee named Michael Abresh who left to work for ID Software on Quake, Newell and his co-worker Mike Harrington both left Microsoft in 1996 and would create Valve on August 24th. Whoa, what a wacky coincidence, that's when I made my Steam account, haha. The first ever intro that Valve made depicted an animation of a man getting a valve into his head. But then Valve would show us another intro that shows Mr. Valve in real life. The story behind the man with the valve in his eye is that Valve sent out agencies into the Seattle Broadway district to find people for the role. They found a man with a goatee and also a heavy built man as well. These two men were for Valve's promotional Open Your Mind, Open Your Eyes campaign, but we wouldn't see the heavy built man until 2007. Till this day, both us and Valve have no idea who the men are. For the first game, Valve wanted to make a horror-style shooter, and they wanted to use the Quake engine, so 70% of Quake's code was modified, adding things like skeletal animations. And Half-Life was chosen as the game's name because it didn't sound cliché. The symbol that we see for Half-Life is a lowercase lambda, which is in the Greek alphabet. And on November 8th of 1998, Half-Life would release. Originally, Team Fortress was a mod for Quake, and Valve seemed interested in Team Fortress, so they hired the Quake team to make Team Fortress into a mod for Half-Life, and Team Fortress Classic would be released in 1999. And then the expansion pack to Half-Life called Opposing Force came out. In 2000, Mike Harrington would leave Valve, leaving Gabe Newell as the face of Valve. Around the same year, a man named Min Lee would create a popular Half-Life mod named Counter-Strike. He would eventually hand over the rights to Valve, and the game would be released in 2000. And then in 2001, two expansion packs for Half-Life were released, Half-Life Decay and Half-Life Blue Shift. Dave Defeat also began as a Half-Life mod. It was first available to download on the internet until Valve purchased it, and Activision would be the publisher. It would be released on May 6th of 2003. It became clear to Valve that some people were having trouble updating their online games for patches. It didn't take long for Valve to come up with the idea of Steam. Besides helping Valve to update games for all players, Steam would also be a good way to fix piracy and cheat issues, and Steam would be released a year later in 2003. The same year, Half-Life 2 would be announced. It used a whole new engine named the Source Engine instead of Gold Source. The Source Engine has helped with the physics of the game and also to make the high dynamic range rendering. Before Half-Life 2's release though, Valve had an internal network hack. The game's code, models, and maps, and even an early version of the game were leaked. But Valve has claimed that a man behind the hack goes by the name Axel Gemby. He contacted Gabe through email and continued to talk with him. Gabe tricked Gemby into believing that Valve was impressed with his skills and wanted to hire him as a security auditor. He even offered a paid flight to America. Clearly though, this was all a trick. And then Axel was like, wait a minute, this doesn't seem right. But when the German government found out, they arrested him in Germany instead. And then the remake of Counter-Strike using the new Source engine called Counter-Strike Source would release. Half-Life and Dave Defeat also got the Source engine. And 15 days later, Half-Life 2 would be released. On Christmas Eve, Gary Newman and Facepunch Studios would release the first free version of Gary's mod. And in 2005, a game called Narbacular Drop was released by some students at the DigiPen Institute of Technology. Gabe Newell was so impressed with the game that he hired the students to work at Valve. In the middle of that, Half-Life 2 Episode 1 would release in 2006, and after 2 years with the work and only 10 people, Portal would be released on October 9th of 2007. Only a day later, TF2 would be released, after being revealed at E3 in 1999. Of course, since then, it's gone a more cartoony style and a few other changes. Then Half-Life 2 Episode 2 would release. Also in 2007, in collaboration with EA, the Orange Box would be released. This included Half-Life 2, with Episode 1 and 2 included, Portal, and also Team Fortress 2. This was an amazing bundle, but Valve actually blamed EA for the port not being good. And then up next, in 2005, Turtle Rock Studios would start working on a game called Left 4 Dead. The game was unveiled in 2006 and was first playable in 2007. Valve, though, would acquire Turtle Rock in 2008 and would release Left 4 Dead on November 17th of 2008. And when a sequel to Left 4 Dead came to mind, some ideas were thrown around like a name called Back 4 More, but in the end it was called Left 4 Dead 2, which would be released literally exactly 1 year after the first one. Following that, the first Steam sale would happen. At E3 2010, Valve would reveal Portal 2. One of the oddest things about this reveal is that it happened at a PlayStation conference. And Gabe Newell at first didn't really say some nice things about PlayStation, but he took them back.
Now, I've been pretty outspoken in my comments about the current generation of game consoles, so I'd really like to thank everyone at Sony for their gracious hospitality and for not repeatedly punching me in the face. If I seem a little nervous, it's because Kevin Butler was introduced to me backstage as the VP of sharpening things.
A year later though, Portal 2 would release. Valve wanted to port CSS onto other video game consoles, but they eventually realized that they had so much content in this port that they wanted to make the port into its own game. So they turned it into CSGO, and it was released on August 21st of 2012. Speaking of 2012, it was a pretty big year for Steam, because this is when they began to realize that they could put the console and the computer into one. They did this with Big Picture, and it made playing games on the television more enjoyable. Also, Steam Greenlight was introduced. This would allow developers to show their games in which users can vote to make Valve approach developers to give it the green light. And also get this, EA wanted to try and buy Valve for only $1 billion. EA has been trying to do this for a while, and Gabe Newell basically said,
No.
I think it's pretty obvious at the time why. Valve is actually valued in 2012 as $3 billion, according to one source, and it's growing a lot, so there's no reason to sell. And Gabe Newell said that he would rather disintegrate the company. So on top of the offer being way too low, and also the company not struggling at all, doing extremely well, and also not even wanting to be sold, this deal did not progress very far. It became clear to Valve that some employees were showing interest in a game called Defense of the Ancients, also known as Dota. IceFrog agreed for Valve to make Dota 2 and release it on July of 2013. To expand on Valve's vision of putting the PC on a television, on November 10th of 2015, both the Steam Link and Steam Controller would hit the market, allowing for a mouse controller hybrid. And the Steam Link helped a lot of players that had gigantic, heavy PCs by allowing them to really just stream their games onto the television, instead of having to move them. This was also around the time when Valve began experimenting with Steam machines, and also when OpenVR started. On top of that, Source 2 would be announced, and a year later, the HTC Vive would be released, which was developed by both Valve and HTC. There was also a game called The Lab that came out. It had short demo VR experiences, but in 2017, Valve killed Greenlight after it was abused deliberately to make games to sell cards and profit off easily. So Valve instead introduced Steam Direct. All you had to do was pay $100 and confirm that you're a real person, and for the most part, that was it. And then potentially someone who used to work at Valve posted a story claiming that it's Half-Life 2 Episode 3. I don't think we'll ever get Half-Life 3 as of now, but oh man, just imagine. A bridge constructing game that takes place in Portal was made. I think that we've caught up pretty well. The online game Artifact is coming out. Not really the game we wanted though. Other than that, we do have a co-writer of Portal 2, Jay Pinkerton, works at Valve again, and yeah. Valve is one of the companies that has shaped the way that we play games. Time and time again, they kept dropping some of the most memorable games that we'll ever play. These are games that we're not just gonna look back on and say, wow, remember when we used to play them? These are games that we continue to play every single day like they just came out. Steam has really helped the PC though, because now we have a place where almost every single game can be purchased. Valve has revealed in 2015 that they have over 150 million users. It's been 3 years, so that number is a lot more now. And it all started with a man, and another guy, who left a big company to start their own. But I guess it's like G-Man put it, the right man in the wrong place can make all the difference in the world.
light flashing at me telling me that I don't get to answer the third question.